After the break, passengers on the tram which crashed, killing seven people, tell an inquest they heard a driver say he blacked out. Tonight, the driver of a tram that crashed in Croydon may have been asleep. The prosecution says Alfred Doris was in a micro-sleep when the tram came off the tracks, killing seven people. The woman accused of failing to investigate Sarah Everard's killer, Wayne Cousins, admits she made errors. The MP who wants to swap Westminster for City Hall and scrap the ULEZ expansion and... Sleezing and teasing, I'm sitting on it. Winning big, the Londoner who ditched her record label to go it alone is rewarded with one of the highest honours in music. Good evening. Passengers on a tram that crashed, killing seven people, have told a court they heard the driver say he blacked out. Alfred Doris is on trial at the Old Bailey over the fatal crash in Croydon in 2016. Doris was going more than three times the speed limit when the train derailed, coming out of a tunnel on the approach to Sandylands tram stop. Today, the prosecution argued he may have had a micro-sleep while driving. Rags Martel reports.
A tram driver arriving at court. Alfred Doris, seen here on the left, is on trial facing a charge of failing to take reasonable care at work. A crash that killed seven people in Croydon in 2016 and injured almost all other passengers on board. Today, the Old Bailey heard about the moments immediately after tram 2551 derailed, speeding at 70 kilometres an hour through a bend, more than three times the safe limit to turn that corner. The court heard from passenger Joseph McCoy, who recalled seeing the tram lights flickering before seeing his own feet suddenly flung in the air. He then tried to reach the driver of the tram, who was not responding. I used my phone as a torch, he said, to see what was going on in the driver's cabin. Eventually, the driver came round and I heard him say, I must have blacked out. The prosecution alleged Mr. Doris might have had a so-called micro-sleep while driving. That's a form of sleep typified by the slow closure of eyes, often lasting just a minute. The court's been told it's usually followed by momentary confusion. The jury then heard from another passenger who broke down in tears, giving her evidence. Georgina Reeves was also travelling close to the driver Alfred Doris, and after the crash, she heard him say, I must have passed out. Other tram drivers also spoke in court, describing how extra care was needed while passing the curve at Sandylands and a slow speed was essential. Mr. Doris, seen here in the middle, denies the charge against him. The trial continues. Rags Martel, ITV News, at the Old Bailey.
The London Fire Brigade is warning people about the risks of charging their e-scooters and e-bikes at home. Have a look at these pictures. The service have released this dramatic footage of an e-scooter exploding in a kitchen in Brent last weekend. They say they've been called to 60 similar incidents so far this year.
People can help prevent these fires in their homes, which can have a real devastating effect on people, by just following some simple guidance as part of our Charge Safe campaign, such as buying from a reputable seller, making sure you only use the correct charger for the battery, don't charge or store it in an escape route in case a fire does start.
Paul Scully has announced his bid to follow in Boris Johnson's footsteps as the next Conservative Mayor of London. The Sutton and Cheam MP sat down with our political correspondent Simon Harris. Simon, did he give you any insight into his plans for City Hall?
Yes, Duncan. Paul Scully is now one of seven Tories to declare they want to be the Conservative candidate in next year's mayoral election. When I spoke to him earlier, I asked him what he would do about the ULEZ extension if he beats Sadiq Khan next May.
Extension, I would scrap day one. I really hope it doesn't come in. I hope the mayor sees sense. I hope the court case succeeds or one of the other areas of investigation to stop that happening. But should it be there in August, by May, the extension will be stopped should I be
what
mayor.
What about air quality? Look, people's lives?
Yeah, I mean, ULEZ in central London works. It works really well because there's proper alternatives, and that's where the concentration of cars are. But the cost to the benefit is just doesn't work out. It's about reducing air pollution, according to the mayor's own records, by 1.5%. It talks about it's negligible. So punishing people with a £12.50 fine is just way too much. Use the money to have a better scrappage system, to carry on the electrification.
But the money will
of the buses.
Already have been spent by the time of the mayoral election. It'll have gone.
Yeah, but we need to work out how we get to the next stage. That's why I'm asking the mayor to pause it now. That's why people are rising and saying stop it now, so that the mayor that doesn't spend more of that money.
But you can't win, can you?
Absolutely, I can win. You know, if you see people looking at Sadiq Khan for the first time because of the ULEZ, they've seen this inactivity, they've seen this deflection over years. Finally, they've seen him make a decision, and they hate the decision that he's taken. So they're now looking behind it. They're looking about how rude, obnoxious, and the approach that he takes to scrutiny, the scrutineers, when he looks at the London Assembly, the disparaging way he treats them. Just think what he's doing behind the scenes for Londoners.
The Conservatives will announce who's won the contest to be the party's mayoral candidate in July. Also tonight, we'll ask whether home ownership is a vanishing dream for a generation of Londoners. I'll be joined by MPs Marcia de Cordova and Theresa Villars, along with Baroness Ollie Grender, to discuss the housing crisis. That's the late debate, Duncan, here on ITV1 after news at 10.
We'll be watching. Simon, thank you very much. The mastermind of an online fraud shop who conned victims out of more than £100 million spent the money on luxury cars and jewellery. Last year, TJ Fletcher was revealed to be the founder and administrator of the scam website iSpoof when it was brought down in the UK's biggest fraud sting. Today, a court heard Fletcher had spent his victims' money on two Range Rovers for him and his girlfriend and £230,000 on a Lamborghini and at least one Rolex. And some of London's top tourist attractions, including Tower Bridge and the Barbican Centre, could be forced to close as workers strike in a dispute over pay. About 900 City of London Corporation employees will walk out for 24 hours on the 25th of May. The GMB union say their members do not take this action lightly, but their pay demands have been falling on deaf ears for months. Next tonight, a former Met police officer who is accused of failing to properly investigate Wayne Cousins over two reports of flashing has admitted she made some errors. If Samantha Lee is found guilty, she could be banned from serving in any police force again. Antoine Allen is at New Scotland Yard for us now. Antoine, what else did she have to say today?
Yesterday, the former police officer Samantha Lee admitted that there was CCTV footage at Wayne Cousins at the restaurant in McDonald's where he admitted to flashing two female members of staff. But she went on to say this at the hearing. I accept that I could have done more around the CCTV and the evidence gathering. That was an error on my part. I accept that. And as much as I fought it over and over, I don't believe that anything I could have done would have changed the tragic outcome of what happened later that day. By that, she means when Wayne would go on to kidnap and murder Sarah Everard on the same day that Samantha Lee, when she was a serving police officer, was at the restaurant where he admitted to two different incidents. So if we do recap, just days before Wayne Cousins murdered Sarah Everard on the 3rd of March, he admitted to going to a McDonald's restaurant, going to the drive-thru and flashing two female members of staff. Now, the manager of that restaurant called the police and Miss Lee went to attend and investigate. What we do know is she says that she was told that the CCTV footage from the drive-through automatically deletes itself, but the restaurant has other CCTV footage. Now, the point of contention is whether the restaurant manager, Mr. Taylor, showed her that CCTV footage. Now, he says that he did. He gave her witness statements and receipts, whereas she says that he only explained how the CCTV footage worked, and she didn't inquire as to whether there was any further CCTV footage that could have shown Wayne Cousins' car registration. Now, the hearing has to decide which person is telling the truth in that matter. Now, Samantha Lee has admitted she was only shown that CCTV footage. The disciplinary hearing has to decide whether she's committed gross misconduct. If she has, then it means that she can no longer serve as a police officer ever again.
Antoine, thank you. still to come. The sun is shining and finally it looks like it's here to stay. We'll have the weather forecast plus. I'll be chatting to one of the stars of a new campaign to make us all more accepting of people with visible differences.
And I've been on the red carpet at the Ivors with some of London's stars like Ray. How are you feeling, Ray?
Great.
But first, London's Violence Reduction Unit is spending £4 million on a new programme that will better identify children with special educational needs and give them earlier support with communication skills. It's because new research has found children with those extra needs are four times more likely to go on to be excluded from school, and those exclusions can have a lifelong impact, as Daniel Henry now reports.
If you ever had a problem with somebody, do these lessons help you find ways to solve it?
Yes.
Today, these children learned how to deal with conflict in the classroom.
It helps me solve it. Sometimes, like, when somebody does something to me and then I try to solve it by doing something instead of just standing there.
I've actually been through that. It was hard to cope with it. These lessons kind of help with coping with it.
That. The head teacher here says conversations like this can change lives.
I haven't had to do any exclusions, and the reason why is because...
You haven't had to do any exclusions?
Any exclusions. This year, no exclusions. Last year, no exclusions. And the reason why is because our children truly understand what a good relationship is and what a bad relationship is, or their friendship skills. And when there are issues, they're able to unpick it and we're able to discuss it with the children.
Sessions like this are supported by London's Violence Reduction Unit. They're designed to help everyone, especially children with special educational needs, because they are four times more likely to be excluded from school. Islington has one of the highest rates of exclusions in the country, with close to 1 in 100 pupils being educated in schools for excluded students. Exclusions have a long-term impact too. New research shows almost half of people in prison were permanently excluded.
I looked up a few years ago. What we found was a lot of the people that were in prison had speech and language and communication difficulties as their SEN main need. And actually, that's one of the highest areas of need within my school. So that's why these types of projects need to be funded, and that's why these programs are so important, because it's not just playing a game, it's giving the children the toolkits to be able to communicate.
It's really important, if you're looking at prevention, that you are starting early and that you're thinking in all of the different ways through a young person's life you can make an impact. And that's an impact on the young person, and it's an impact around the youth workers or the teachers that they're working with, but it also has to be an impact in a system.
Three, two, one. The funding for this scheme will be rolled out across seven London boroughs when schools come back after the summer break. Daniel Henry, ITV News.
Next tonight, she survived a plane crash when she was 10 years old, but lost her parents and her brother. Tulsi Vaghjani also had severe burns to her face and body. Now she's leading a campaign for better representations of people with visible differences.
What did you see that made you exclude me? What did you see that made you leave me out? Why did you fear me? Mock me? Judge me? Shame me? Threaten me? Ignore me?
Tulsi, that was you, wasn't it? Showing pictures of you as a child.
Yeah.
It's incredibly personal, isn't it?
Actually, was it? I didn't realise the severity of it until watching the actual video clip come together.
Yeah. Tell us about the campaign you're now leading this week.
Yeah, this week we're doing This Is Me.
Yeah.
We just want to say we will not hide. You know, we want to be represented in a positive light in the mainstream media, in popular culture, even in the workplace. You know, often or not, I go to places and there's no one that looks like me. So I had no one to look up to at the age of 10. So I suffered in silence. And you can imagine, like, my mental health, you know, was really weak at the time and I had no support. So what we want to say is we want better representation. So someone with a visible difference, whether they acquire it or they're born with it, they've got a fair chance at life.
What might that visible representation look like? You're talking about more people on TV?
Yeah, on TV, you know, someone who's just pulling a pint in the Queen Vic.
Yeah.
Or just the main heroine or hero in a film. Or, you know, just someone in the background who just is part of society. You know, end of the day, I'm here, this is me, I'm not going to hide. So yeah. There's so many people who live a really positive life with a visible difference. You know, we don't want to show a negative light on this at all. You know, I'm lucky that I'm getting to fulfil and live my dreams, but it's taken such a long time. So if we had better representation, I feel people would be more confident at a younger age.
Yeah. You mentioned negative stereotypes and you mentioned films, because it's such an old trope, isn't it, that the villain or a victim has scarring, and that's our easy way, allegedly, of, you know, of telling that they're that kind of person. It's lazy, isn't it?
It's just a lazy script writing, really, isn't it? You know, you're just one script writing away from a really positive representation. You know, I was called Freddy Krueger when I was growing up, and I didn't even know who Freddy Krueger was. I thought it was someone cool, only to be told that it's a villain. And then that's how I thought the world saw me, as a negative person. Mm. You know, people would cross the road in case they caught something, or name calling, or, you know, just excluding me for so much. Like the video said, why did you leave me out? You know, why did you fear me? It's more about, let's make this more personable, let's show compassion, and you know, let's have better representation. Yeah.
That's the thing, is because if we see these differences all the time on our TVs, in our lounge every night, then when we go into a workplace or into a class and we see someone who has a difference, it's not going to be that noteworthy, is it?
No, it's just going to be normal, you know, like it's
as
just...
it should be.
It should be, right? Yeah. Like everything we see, you know, we don't realise how popular culture has actually influenced us. I didn't even realise that having, you know, a visible difference was associated with villainy until I did I'm Not Your Villain campaign and realised actually how many people have been compared to a villain.
Yeah.
And we shouldn't be living like that, you know. We all deserve a fair chance. We're all nice people. And, yeah, we shouldn't be seen in a negative light.
No. You're a great role model. Tulsi, thank you so much
for
coming in.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. The Princess of Wales has been at the Anna Freud Centre in Islington today to hear about a new anxiety toolkit they have developed. Kate spent the morning with some of the school children who helped the charity develop the initiative. She was shown a range of activity cards that can be used by pupils who are affected by anxiety. She said she was leaving feeling inspired. The singer-songwriter Ray has told ITV News London there is no higher honour than winning an Ivor Novello Award. The musician from Tooting has just won Best Contemporary Song at the prestigious awards for her number one single, Escapism. And she's just one of a host of winners from the capital, as Anna Geary now reports.
It was the breakup anthem that catapulted this South Londoner to stardom. Escapism went viral on TikTok and took Ray to the top of the charts. Today, the track gained recognition as Best Contemporary Song at the Ivors. Not bad, considering the 25-year-old left her record label in 2021 and released her new album independently. From a glitzy red carpet in Mayfair, the singer was delighted.
I don't think there's any higher honour as a songwriter, especially British songwriter. I started writing songs from the age of 7, 8. I have terrible recordings, but the intention was there from a very young age. I had no social life. I was just like, I need to be the best that I can possibly be.
Also awarded at the Ivors was London songwriter and producer Camille. Boasting Little Mix among her high-profile clientele responsible for songs like this, today she won a gong for Outstanding Song Collection, and she opted for a sustainable outfit made of tyres.
I come to the Ivors every year and never get one, so it's so nice that finally I'm getting one this year.
I just had a baby and I'm back on the red carpet, and so making music is like nothing compared to having a baby. I'm so chill. I'm like namaste. And yeah, it's been an amazing experience, but I want women to know you can have a baby and have your career. That's why I'm here.
But taking home the highest honour today was Sting. With more than 100 million albums sold with The Police and as a solo artist, he becomes an Ivors Academy Fellow.
British songwriting is one of our major exports as a country. It's a very important export. And this fellowship, if you like, this organisation supports that huge industry, not just established songwriters, but up-and-coming songwriters. And that's important, that their rights are protected.
Sadly, Londoner KJ Radical missed out on a win for this track, but he's already plotting his return for next year after chasing some sunshine first.
Beaches, feet up, do you get me? A couple shells, coconuts, do you know what I'm saying? All of that. Find some inspiration, soak it up, write something else that slaps, come back here, do it all again, get a new suit, do you know what I'm saying? Can't wear this one again.
Hard, perhaps, to beat the fashion choices of this year's awards. For now, the capital will bask in its creative achievements. Anna Geary, ITV News.
And we've been basking in sunshine, haven't we? And for once, I'm glad to say it is hanging around for the weekend. Here's Chris Page now with the forecast.
ITV London weekday weather is sponsored by Octopus Electric Vehicles. Car, charger and energy.
Hello there. Very good evening to you. There has been quite a bit of sunshine across the capital today. A gorgeous start first thing this morning. These are the scenes in Kensington Gardens, as you can see here. A little hazy sunshine into this afternoon as well as higher clouds starting to drift its way in. And for one or two of us as well, there has been the odd rogue shower. Now, this weather front will glide southwards as we go through this evening and overnight into tomorrow, just destabilising the atmosphere a little bit, bringing some rather sharp showers for a time tomorrow. But I think they'll drift westwards and eventually we'll see something a touch brighter for all of us as we end Friday. But back to the here and now, for the rest of this evening and overnight, we've got some clear skies around. There is a little bit more thickening cloud through the night and we'll start to see that weather front that we spoke about just starting to show its hand with some showers gradually creeping in to the northern home counties. By no means a cold start, temperatures 9, 10 degrees Celsius, just cloud tending to come and go through tomorrow. Some sunny spells, but you'll notice a scattering of those showers tending to drift westwards, turning drier later with top temperatures of 16 to 19 degrees Celsius. That's 66 in Fahrenheit. As we go through the rest of the weekend, well, we hold on to some sunshine. In fact, in that sunshine too, with the light winds, it will feel warm. The pollen is next.
ITV London weekday weather is sponsored by Octopus Electric Vehicles.
Hello, summer. Piri sponsors ITV Pollen Count.
And as we go through the rest of the week and into the weekend, it looks like our pollen levels will remain at low. We've just started to see the beginning of the grass pollen season. But if you're still seeing a few sniffles, that's because the moderate pollen levels of oak. Take care.
And finally, to the People's Projects, which gives you the chance to help decide where thousands of pounds of National Lottery funding is spent. Every night this week, we'll be showcasing a project that hopes to improve the lives of people in their community. The People's Projects is a partnership between ITV and the National Lottery Community Fund. And this evening, we're highlighting the work of Sport for Futures, who help young disadvantaged people into football.
The project that we're sort of now trying to expand and to run more consistently for a longer period of time is a holistic sports programme for young people.
Mahmood, step up into their half.
It's a very expensive area around here, so young people can't often, you know, buy memberships for private classes and things like that. And the project has also got these other elements to it where we're taking young people to football tournaments, professional football matches. We've just had five staffing young people do a level one football coaching qualification so that they can run their own sessions. It's a really big, ambitious project, but it will have a massive impact on a lot of young people.
Sometimes you can go to a pitch and it'll be £120 for an hour. And you're like, for a bunch of 14 to 16 year olds, where are they going to get £120 from to play football for an hour?
Get into a little formation to stand on the weekend.
We wanted to find the best route of making football more accessible for young people in this area. A lot of kids are from different estates in this area, and so we noticed that we're in the heart of SE1, and so we have a lot of popular demand when it comes to these kids wanting to actually just go out and express themselves through sport.
Wait for the right moment, wait for the right moment.
I'm no different to one of these kids. I grew up in a similar area, South London, And I noticed that that was a huge barrier to me becoming a footballer, not having the accessibility around me, not having the right coaches. And so I thought it was a way for me to step in there and actually be the example, be the role model that these kids can try and thrive off of and have fun, you know?
When I first started, technically I wasn't that good. You know, I wasn't good, like, football-wise, mentality-wise. I feel like it's brought me up a lot, you know? It's taught me a lot. When Sheldon's talking, just giving them that respect. For example, like, not playing with the football, like, not messing around. It's just that respect that you take outside, you just take into life. Like, before I was here, I was, you know, at home, chilling. I wasn't really taking football as serious as I could. Then this came around, you know, I was going more frequently. I was enjoying myself. I had more passion. You know, I just fell in love with football since. And then, you know, I've just been here every day, man.
Vote for us!
The three projects with the most votes will receive a grant of up to £70,000, and the runners-up will be awarded up to £10,000. To vote, go to ITV. And that is it. That's all we've got time for now. But Mary is here next with the ITV Evening News. From me and the rest of the London team, have a lovely evening. Bye-bye.